Good morning, everybody. Welcome to this Google Hangout with Professor Ken Nono from Emory University, Atlanta, United States, and Dilip D'Souza. This is a Hangout initiated by Ganom as part of the yearly celebrations of the legendary Srinivasa Ramanujan's birthday, which is just around the corner. So Ganom is an organization, it's a not-for-profit organization whose aim is to make resources available to students who are interested in science, math, and English, and to transform education, the education scene in India, by working with teachers, other like-minded NGOs, and so on. And we hope to do this by using technology meaningfully. And this year we are very pleased to have Ken Ono, who is a professor of mathematics at Emory University, Atlanta, and is also a great devotee of Ramanujan. He is, in fact, one of the co-producers of the movie The Man Who Knew Infinity, which is based on the book by Robert Kanigal. And speaking to him is Dilip D'Souza, who's a columnist for the Light Mint newspaper and who's also very interested in science and maths and was previously a computer scientist, but who decided to combine his passion for science and writing together. And he's looking forward to doing this interview, so let me not be between him and Ken and Dilip. Dilip and Ken, over to you. And looking forward to hearing the two of you interact.
Thanks, Sujata. This is truly a privilege to chat with Ken Ono. You introduced him pretty well, and thank you for saying the nice things about me too. Just to tell the audience a little bit more about Ken Ono, he studied at the University of Chicago and then at UCLA, but very interestingly, he was also a competitive bicyclist at University of Chicago, and he is, I believe now is also a competitive triathlete, which is says a lot about him as a mathematician in some ways. And he's won plenty of research and teaching awards and made a name for himself as a number theorist, but also as Sujata told us, he is very interested in Ramanujan. So we are now about to celebrate in the National Mathematical Day in India, which is Ramanujan's birthday in another few days, on December 22nd. And because of that interest, that's why I'm interested in talking to Ken about Dr. Ono about Ramanujan and a lot else. So I know a little bit, Dr. Ono, about how you developed an interest in Ramanujan, but you've talked about it before in a similar hangout you had about a year ago, and I'm sure you've talked about it elsewhere. But your advisor, Basil Gordon, actually sparked your interest. Can you start by telling us a little bit about his study of Ramanujan and how that sparked yours?
Well, first of all, good morning, Dilip. It's wonderful to have this opportunity to be on this Google Hangout, and I always like to talk about Ramanujan. I have to say that my father was a math professor. He was a professor at Johns Hopkins for many years, and so at first glance, it might not come as a surprise that I ended up myself becoming a mathematician, but I credit my PhD advisor, Basil Gordon, for really being the person who sparked my love for and my passion for mathematics. Before graduate school, I could do well on examinations, right? I could memorize material. I was a robotic student. But my PhD advisor, who was a genius, he's not as well known as I think he should be, he's the one who sparked my interest. We would meet every week at his house in Los Angeles, only a few blocks from the beach. It's a very beautiful place. And we would work for 2 or 3 hours each Saturday. And what was very ironic, or I should say unusual about Basil Gordon, is that he was a Renaissance man. He was an accomplished writer. He was an accomplished musician. And it was his habit to start our weekly meetings with a poetry reading, or he would play the piano, maybe a Chopin nocturne. And his point is that mathematics is hard. We're confused all the time. And it's not about solving equations. It's looking for beauty in formulas and theory. And if we weren't in the proper frame of mind, how could we produce beautiful mathematics? So that was, I found, very surprising. No teacher or mentor before had ever tried to make me see mathematics that way. And what he did was he used Ramanujan as a role model, as someone who succeeded not because of ordinary school training and not because of ordinary coursework, but as a man who saw beauty in formulas. And so Ramanujan was an inspiration for Gordon. And of course, I knew about Ramanujan long before I worked with Gordon, but it was during the year of 1991 when Robert Kanigal's book, The Man Who Knew Infinity, came out. Basil Gordon and I, we went to the bookstore, we bought copies, and we read the book together. And, you know, Basil is no longer alive. He regretfully passed away 2 years ago. But, you know, I don't want to cry, but I'll tell you, Basil Gordon was an amazing man, and he helped me find myself. So I hope that I could be to my PhD students, you know, 10% of what Basil Gordon was to me. He was that important. And Ramanujan was one of his great heroes.
Dr. Ono, I mean, I have two quick reactions to what you said. At one point you said you were a robotics student. I hope that you mean that in the plural and not the singular. You were not a robotic student, were you?
Oh, no, I was literally a robotic student. If you told me to read chapters 1, 2, and 3 by tomorrow, I would do it mechanically, just because I was told to do it. I wasn't thinking about the content. I wasn't thinking about the subject and trying to take ownership of the subject. I viewed my studies as a formula. To succeed, you take these classes. To succeed, you have to get these grades. You're supposed to go to these schools, so on and so forth. And quite frankly, that completely misses the point. And Ramanujan is someone who did none of that. And yeah, that's what we have to learn from his story.
And the other thing, the other reaction, quick reaction I had is that you mentioned how you view Basil Gordon as a Renaissance man. And I mean, in some ways, wouldn't you say that the best mathematicians are actually Renaissance men because they're interested in a whole set of different subjects? I'm going to suggest to you that you are one such because of your interest in a number of other subjects too.
Well, Dilip, thank you for calling me a Renaissance man. I don't think I am. I'm not very eloquent. I know Basil Gordon, people like G.H. Hardy and others, they are what I consider to be Renaissance men. In fact, I'm writing a book right now, and there's in this book I refer to Basil Gordon as my G.H. Hardy. Hardy was a brilliant mathematician, but you know, as a young college student, he almost decided to pursue other subjects, philosophy, history, but I'm thankful he chose mathematics.
Okay, well, so let's get to Ramanujan, whom we're talking about. So I've always been fascinated, Dr. Ono, by how Ramanujan found so many different formulae for pi in particular. And I'm going to show, I don't know if this is a good way to do this, it's a low-tech way to do this, but here are three formulae, if that's visible. You know, did he have a particular interest in pi, or did pi just pop up as he was studying other infinite series and so on? I mean, what's your idea about that?
Well, it's an excellent question. I don't think that Ramanujan, if he were around today, would be very surprised that we celebrate Pi Day around, all over the world on March 14th. I think he would find that strange. And so I guess the short answer to your question is that Pi would have certainly been an important number to Ramanujan, but it wasn't important because it's this crazy figure that he was trying to pursue for many different reasons. Rather, it's that pi appears in so many different areas of number theory as a critical constant, and perhaps it's a better testament to the taste that he had in mathematics that a lot of the formulas he produced ended up involving pi. Hypergeometric functions dating to the early works of Gauss involve objects called elliptic integrals. These are like related to volumes, and whenever you're computing a volume of an area of things that have arcs, you expect pi to appear. But also, Ramanujan was a world expert on continued fractions, and he found very beautiful expressions for pi. I gave a lecture yesterday at the International Center for Theoretical Science, and I made a point of it to say that to most of us, pi is this impossibly difficult number. There are some people who memorized 100 digits of pi, 3.14, 100 digits, but at some point, you have to say pi is 3.14, and eventually nobody knows, right? There's no repeating pattern. But the thing is, Ramanujan, when he wrote down pi as, in terms of continued fractions, it's very easy to see the pattern. And Ramanujan's formulas for pi are perhaps some of the best examples of beautiful symmetric formulas where most people would think that nobody knows that there are any formulas.
But related to that, I wanted to ask you, does pi particularly lend itself to being calculated this way, whether by infinite series or whether by continued fractions, or does that also happen with e and with root 2 and, you know, other the golden ratio, other irrationals and so on? Is it just pi or are these other numbers also popping up in these infinite series?
Pardon me, all of the numbers that you just mentioned, pi, e, the square root of 2, if you were to write them down as base 10 in their base 10 expansions, the decimal expansions are chaotic sequences of numbers, right? It's not like 1/3 where you have infinitely many threes. There's no repeating patterns. These constants are very complicated. But that doesn't mean that they can't be tamed and be made into beautiful symmetric expressions. So Ramanujan was very good at finding these formulas, and these formulas are of very different categories. Square root of 2 and numbers like the golden ratio are a little bit simpler than, say, e and pi. But Ramanujan's formulas, he found equally beautiful formulas for all of them.
I didn't know that. I didn't know that he had found formulae for other irrationals too. But that's the core of what I want to get at today. Is can you give us an idea of how Ramanujan came up with these formulae at all? I mean, what is the process in his head? After all, these are not the kinds of things that somebody like me is going to be just thinking about or playing around with numbers, even though I have an interest in numbers. How did this young man in rural Tamil Nadu come up with these ideas? What was going through his head?
Well, okay, that's, to answer your question, Dilip, I wish I knew what was going on in his head. If I had a time machine, if there was one person in my life I would like to go back in time and meet, it would be Ramanujan. So I can't offer you a rock-solid answer, but let me do my best. And the easiest examples to start with would be the golden ratio. The golden ratio is this number phi. It's expressed as 1 plus the square root of 5 over 2. That's a little bit complicated. Some people express the golden ratio as the limits of the successive terms in the Fibonacci sequence. Right? And but the representation I liked most is the representation by a continued fraction. A continued fraction is that expresses the golden ratio requires only knowing the number 1. It's 1 plus 1 divided by 1 plus 1 divided by, and you go on forever. And that's a beautiful expression. You could teach this to bright high school students. All you need to know is the quadratic formula to realize that is the golden ratio. And for very bright students, bright students will quickly discover that the expression for the golden ratio as a continued fraction is shared by lots of quadratic irrationals. Now, what did Ramanujan do? Ramanujan certainly knew this fact. He probably knew this as a 5 or 6-year-old, quite frankly. And instead of being content with knowing this kind of theory, it's a theory that Euler developed quite rigorously, he decided to throw in a parameter. Why don't I consider a continued fraction, not in terms of numbers, but in terms of variables, where if you let the variables if you choose the variables to be simple numbers like 1, you would happen to get back the golden ratio. And he then asked, well, if you did this, what kind of numbers would you get if you chose numbers other than Q? Would that open up a whole new world for other kinds of expressions? Well, Ramanujan did this, and in the 19th century, mathematicians would have tried to do this, but it would have been an audacious task, because Euler had developed this kind of theory of continued fractions, and the more complicated theory just didn't seem possible. Well, Ramanujan did this, and in his very first last letter to Hardy, Ramanujan ended with three formulas. And these three formulas are called the Rogers-Ramanujan continued fraction, and these are the formulas that stunned Hardy. They astonished him. These are the formulas that Hardy responded by saying, they must be true because and Ramanujan must be a genius because no one would possibly have the imagination to invent them. So how did Ramanujan end up producing that? That's a great question, but all I can tell you for sure is that he did, and his and I'm so thankful that he did, because it's a gift to the world of mathematics. There have been over 7,000 papers just that mathematicians have written over the last 100 years based on those two or three lines.
So Hardy had no idea about those three equations at all?
Oh, he had no idea. None whatsoever.
Okay. Taking off from there, Ken, what do you think it must have been like to be Ramanujan, to think like him, to walk in his shoes, you know, to talk like him? And in fact, I'm asking this because of your relationship with the film that's coming up. Is this the kind of thing, you're a mathematical consultant to the film, is this the kind of thing that you're telling the film crew about, or maybe Dev Patel, the actor, that, you know, this is how you have to act, or this is the kind of mindset that you have to have? Do you have a sense of that?
Well, I did my best, having never met Ramanujan. And there's no footage of Ramanujan, and in fact, there are only two surviving photographs. So there's very little that we can go on. So on the set, as a math consultant, my job was to teach both Jeremy and Dev how to communicate like mathematicians, and to do my best to try to infer what their personalities would have been like, which was actually quite easy to do because Hardy, of course, was the great British-chaired professor. It's easy for us to get. He wrote important books. He was all about step-by-step, the step-by-step concrete formulation of mathematics, whereas Ramanujan was something completely different. And so how did Ramanujan do his work? We don't know. It was certainly not by any procedure we would understand. And so in advising the producer and the director, it was very easy to say, I can't explain this to you. It's a mystery to me. And try to imagine a professor trying to make sense out of someone who has brilliant ideas, which are clearly right, and help them figure out how to bring those ideas to the surface so the rest of the world of mathematicians could understand that.
There's a previous movie, I think the one with, what's this guy, Robin Williams, it's called Good Will Hunting, is that the one where there's a scene where this young tyro mathematician, they sit with this established mathematician, they sit and do some equation on the board. And while I like that movie, that scene always struck me as somewhat hokey. Would you agree? And I mean, are we going to see something different in this upcoming film?
Well, I have to say that Good Will Hunting is one of my favorite movies of all time, and so this is a rather touchy question, a little sensitive for me. The Good Will Hunting is really not a film about mathematics. It's a film about a young man who was struggling with his own identity. He was brilliant, and he was struggling to embrace his brilliance. Ramanujan, in some ways, was obviously very brilliant, but very different in that he embraced his identity as the producer of mathematics. So first of all, the main theme, the way we describe Ramanujan as as a character, a true living human being, is very different from what one found in Good Will Hunting. So to answer your question about how the mathematics is portrayed in The Man Who Knew Infinity versus perhaps all of the other great intellectual prestige films, is that I think our film will be one of the first films where the director took great pains in explaining how a mathematician does his work without compromising the human side of the story. I mean, let's make it quite clear. The idea of Ramanujan is an idea that can resonate with all teachers in the world everywhere. And it's the idea that greatness and talent is often found in the most unforgiving of circumstances. And teachers have the moral responsibility to try to recognize that and then take the next step and nurture these talented students despite whatever circumstances, despite their financial circumstances, despite their religious beliefs, despite their, you know, their countries of origin, all of that. That I think is truly the idea of Ramanujan. And Hardy perhaps was the only living person who could have recognized Ramanujan's talent, and that's what the story is about, how these two men from very different countries, very different cultures, figured out how to work together and produce great mathematics. That's the story that I think we can all take from this.
Why do you say Hardy was the only living mathematician at that time who could have done this?
So I often hear other mathematicians sort of complain that it's a pity that Ramanujan had not sent his letter to Professor X in Germany or someone else, right? Yeah. So on and so forth. It's easy to try to imagine how mathematics would have developed differently had Ramanujan been discovered by someone else. But let's make no... Yeah, pardon me? All right, so I can't hear you, but...
I was saying Henri Poincaré, the French mathematician who lived around the same time. What if Ramanujan had sent his letter there?
So I actually write about this in my book, in the epilogue of my book. This is a question that I feel quite strongly about. And my point is that Hardy was perhaps the only true person who could have recognized Ramanujan's talent. Perhaps Littlewood would have been suitable. But almost everything in Ramanujan's notes involve analysis, classical analysis, and formulas that relate to classical number theoretic constructions. Ramanujan didn't know anything about any of the other standard courses in mathematics, and so here's a better test. If we were to type up Ramanujan's notes and distribute his notes to professors at major universities all over the world, you'll discover that even today in the 21st century, most mathematicians would not know what to make out of his formulas. It takes a very special person to see through pages and pages of formulas with no words to see their value.
Okay, I'll take that from you. We should start wrapping up, but I wanted to talk a little bit more about your journey, Dr. Ono. You've come to Ramanujan, but what was your journey as a child thinking about mathematics? I know you were interested in medicine to start with, but do you have memories from when you were a child about mathematical ideas or mathematics around you in the world? And I ask this particularly because I'm right now reading a really interesting book by this mathematician called John Allen Paulos. I'm sure you know him, at Temple University. His new book called A Numerative Life. And he talks about mathematics being all around him in everything that he was doing. And he saw it everywhere around him. And did you have that kind of feeling growing up that made you think about mathematics as a career?
So, Dilip, I hope I don't disappoint you. as I said, I am myself writing a book. It's called My Search for Ramanujan, How I Learned to Count. That's not a pun. I credit Ramanujan, quite frankly, for almost saving my life. My father was a mathematician. He came of age in the 1940s in Tokyo, and he lived at a very difficult time where Japan was defeated soundly by the United States in World War II. And, well, let me remind everyone that the Japanese government was ruthless. They told their citizens that the emperor was a god, and that his cabinet were also deities of some sort, and that the government even distributed propaganda that said that Japanese citizens are superior to all other races. So that's the world in which my parents grew up in, only to see the true reality of this, you know, crushing defeat. So how do you respond when you're a teenage boy and everything you were told to believe about your place in the world is exposed as a fraud? It's very difficult. So my father, thankfully, was very gifted in mathematics, and together with many friends who also studied mathematics, they ignored all of the struggle around them. They were hungry, there were power shortages, and it's a quite lucky thing that happened to them. They were discovered by a great American mathematician of French descent. His name is André Weil. André Weil, together with many other distinguished mathematicians, traveled to Tokyo to help, you know, share mathematics in the spirit of peace and reconciliation. What André Weil discovered at this meeting were these super hungry, super starving mathematicians. They were hungry in terms of foodstuffs, but they were hungry because they also wanted to make a place for themselves in the world of science. And impressed by their work ethic, Weil brought them to the United States, and many of them ended up on faculties at the world's best universities. Well, try to imagine the United States in the 1950s. You know, Japan attacked the United States in 1941 and to start the World War, and Japanese people were not welcomed by Americans. So try to imagine raising a family where your livelihood depends on your success as a scientist, but your neighbors don't embrace you. And so my family struggled, as you would expect, racial prejudice, probably very much like Ramanujan struggled in when he was in England, and that resonates with me. The problem is, though, that my parents raised us three boys thinking we just had to be really good at science because there was no other way that American culture could accept us. There was a letter from Janaki Amal to my father. I brought the letter to my father. He read it. He started crying. And that's when I first heard the story of Ramanujan. So imagine me, someone who fought with his father all the time, learning about a two-time college dropout who my father looked up to as a hero, so much so that he contributed money to help commission the bust of a statue of a man he never met, a man who died 65 years before, you know, I would be entering high school. How could that be? And that's when we began to understand each other. And so that's where my connection to Ramanujan first became quite personal. And amazingly, over time, like I said, as a graduate student, Gordon and I, we enjoyed the book, The Man Who Knew Infinity by Canigal. You know, everything good in my life has somehow been related to my pursuit of Ramanujan. He helped me find my self-confidence. He helped me reconnect with my family. And everything about my professional success has been related to being, you know, sticking to my guns, wanting to figure out the ideas behind this great man. And it's worked out brilliantly for me.
I have to tell you that listening to that story, even though I've heard it before, it made the little hairs at the back of my neck stand up. So thank you for saying that. I mean, I think there's a lesson there for all of us who are, faced with some difficulty at some point in our lives, and you know, we find inspiration in different ways. Ramanujan found it in certain ways, and you did it in other ways. But you know, I would love to go on chatting, Dr. Ono. This has been such a pleasure. But thank you for doing this, and I hope we can you know, be in touch and talk about Ramanujan and other things mathematical many more times.
All right. Well, thank you, Dilip. If I could just conclude with one brief statement, it's that you know, Ramanujan transformed Hardy. Ramanujan transformed this generation of Japanese mathematicians. So I applaud you and Sujata and everyone who carries on his tradition, because it's not just the mathematics. Maybe for me it's the mathematics, but it's really the idea of Ramanujan. And young people, even old people, middle-aged people, we all need our heroes. And when they are true stories, that's when you have to take note and pay attention, because we all have something to learn from that.
Thank you, Dr. Ono. That was
okay.
That was a pleasure. Okay.
Okay. Good day.
Okay, you too.